Thank you. Good morning. It is good to be worshiping together on this Sunday in green season, the season in which we think about how God is growing us. We gather the day after the convention of the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth, and today you will hear as the sermon the bishop's address. Blessed be the one holy and living God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you have given the Holy Spirit to abide with us forever. Bless, we pray, with the Spirit's grace and presence, the people of God here assembled in your name, that your church, being preserved in true faith and godly discipline, may fulfill all the mind of the one who loves us and gave everything for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us now hear from God's holy word.
The first reading. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the people. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you. The young camels of Midian and Ephah, all those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. For the coastlands shall wait for me, the ships of Tarshish first, to bring your children from far away, their silver and gold with them. For the name of the Lord your God and for the Holy One of Israel, because he has glorified you. the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now we will read in unison Psalm 139. Lord, you have searched me out and know me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting place, and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it all together. You press upon me behind and before, and lay upon your hand. Such knowledge is wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. Where can I go then from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I climb up to heaven, you are there. If I make the grave my bed, you are there also. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the utmost parts of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will cover me, and the light around me turn to night. Darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light to you are both alike.
A reading from 2 Corinthians. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word, but by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slave for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, let light shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Conscience quick to feel.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each heart be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I would like to begin this morning by expressing my gratitude to Karen Califat and the good people of St. Luke's in the Meadow for hosting this diocesan-wide event, and also for my staff, for all the creative and innovative work at putting together this virtual convention. Janet Waggoner, Michelle King, Adriana Klein, Katie Shepherd, and Steve Grenzo. Words like innovative and adaptive and fluid have seen increased usage during this unprecedented year of 2020. I suspect you can think of other words as well. I would like to thank and recognize the work of all of the communicators and IT experts throughout this diocese, as well as the clergy, as you have forever impacted our way of life in the church. Within a month of discovering the seriousness of COVID-19, you were conducting live feed services over the internet, a way of worship which has expanded opportunities for more to participate, and likely a way that's here to stay, even as we one day return to normalcy. You made events like Holy Week and Easter meaningful and even memorable, and ordinations too. So special thanks go to Katie and Steve and all communicators. I would like to thank and express my respect and admiration for our clergy. These last 8 months have been challenging and demanding as clergy have strived to provide forms of worship, exercise pastoral care, and lead congregations during this historic moment of grief, anxiety, and fear. Typically, during a crisis, human beings come together in person, and now we show our love for one another by distancing ourselves physically. It's not natural. It's not how we are created. We are not created to be isolated individuals. We are created to be in communion as one human family. Loving one another by staying away from one another is not natural. And yet it is a sacrificial loving act in this particular moment. Through the wonders of technology, the clergy have met together nearly once a week to exchange ideas, to share experiences, and to support one another. Together we discerned and produced guidelines for reentry to worship, discussing everything from safety precautions to Eucharistic theology. And we've discussed also our role as clergy in leading during this highly fraught time of deep divisions in the culture. You may remember that at last year's diocesan convention, inspired by Bishop Eugene Sutton's address to us, we passed a resolution calling for the establishment of a diocesan commission on racial justice and reparations. This summer, several clergy gathered regularly by Zoom to read and study about anti-racism. I hope you have watched or will watch the video they have produced. We will hear from them later this afternoon with a report, as well as an invitation to join them in this work. This is gospel work. So take a moment in this virtual setting to express gratitude for the sacrificial service and leadership of our clergy. Our former provisional bishop and current assisting bishop, Rayford High, has been honored by the establishment of an endowment by Tim and Sylvia Stevens. Tim and Sylvia Stevens have established the Right Reverend Rayford B. High Jr. Endowment for administrative support for the Mission and Outreach Program. Tim was the chair of the Mission and Outreach Committee for about 5 years, and he helped build the program into what it is today, a program which distributes grant funds, but also does much more, including helping congregations learn to write grants and letting people across the diocese and the Episcopal Church know about the amazing outreach that our congregations are doing. The proceeds from the endowment established by the Stevens will provide much-needed administrative support to help the Mission and Outreach Committee receive and process grant applications, as well as to maintain connections with the grant recipients. From your respective virtual locations, let's show gratitude to Tim and Sylvia Stevens and Rayford High. Each year, I recognize those who have served in the leadership of our diocese and are concluding their service in a particular role or a commission or a committee. In addition to those I named, there are many who agree to continue to serve, and I'm grateful for the work which keeps us moving forward in ministry together. Those who are concluding their work in various roles, commissions, and committees include the following: John Back, Chair of the Constitution and Canons Committee; Andrew Johnson, Member of the Constitution and Canons Committee; Christopher Thomas, Member of the Constitution and Canons Committee; Allison Shepherd, Member of the Schools Commission; Saren Stanford, Member of the Schools Commission; Donna Clopton, Chair of the Mission and Outreach Committee; Tom Foster, Member of the Mission and Outreach Committee; David Shockley, Member of the Finance Committee. So please express your gratitude to these folks who have served the diocese in these capacities. Now, a number of faithful Episcopalians have died since our last gathering for convention, and we will read the names of those who have served in diocesan-wide capacities later during this liturgy. Given it's 2020, most of us were unable to remember and celebrate our loved ones with a nave full of friends and relatives and choirs and congregational singing and celebrations of the Holy Eucharist and homilies with storytelling and eulogizing. And that is a loss. Just as an aside, my mother told me recently that her grandfather, a devout Catholic, died during the Spanish flu in 1918. His burial was a graveside service due to the pandemic. He died 14 years before she was born, and yet she knew that. Obviously, that made an impression on the family. I'd like to take a moment now to eulogize a few of our friends. Richard Chowning. Longtime lay leader Richard Chowning died Friday, July the 10th, 2020. Richard grew up in Fort Worth and graduated from Paschal High School. He attended the University of Texas in Austin on a diving scholarship, and he was in the Air Force serving in combat in Southeast Asia. Upon returning home, Richard became a career real estate broker and mediator. He cared passionately about the growth and development of his congregation, the Diocese, and All Saints Episcopal School. Richard filled many leadership roles at All Saints, but most people knew him as the smiling usher greeting everyone on a Sunday morning. He was a delegate from All Saints to several diocesan conventions. Richard's greatest desire was for the diocese to grow into a healthy, healing place for all, a place where there was room for love, grace, and courage as we sought to share the amazing message of God's unceasing love for everyone. He was funny, outspoken, and always straightforward. He had no hidden agendas. As his health began to deteriorate, his plain-spokenness grew. He had no time to waste with beating around the bush. Richard's wife, Barbara Evans Chowning, continues to serve the diocese and is a delegate to this convention. Johnson Shannon. The Reverend Johnson Shannon, a priest of the diocese, died on April 20th, 2020. Johnson was born July the 30th, 1948 in Fort Worth. He was a graduate of Northside High School, where he began dating his wife, Mary Ellen Hood. After deciding to pursue a call to the priesthood that had tugged at him since serving as an acolyte at St. Anne's, he graduated from Neshota House Episcopal Seminary with a Master of Divinity in 1998. Johnson served St. Albans in Arlington, St. Mary's in Hillsboro, and Our Lady of the Lake in Laguna Park before returning to Fort Worth as a pastoral associate at All Saints, where he retired in 2013. Johnson loved a good joke, TCU football, and Texas Rangers, but he always remained faithful to his childhood love, the Fort Worth Cats. His laugh often entered the room before he did, and he never turned down a good meal. Like his Irish forebears, he loved sharing and hearing a good story. He often described his shop class that he took at J.P. Elder Junior High as his most useful academic endeavor, for it led to his lifelong love of woodworking and tinkering with everything. Johnson Shannon. Henry Penner. The Reverend Henry Penner, a deacon of our diocese, died on Friday, December the 20th, 2019. He served at St. Martin in the Fields in Keller since his ordination on November the 2nd, 2012 at the 30th Diocesan Convention in Stephenville. Bishop Wallace Ole ordained him, with the newly elected Provisional Bishop Rayford High assisting. Henry served on the Commission on Ministry, working with those discerning a call to ministry and in deacon formation. He worked in risk management, where he used his experience from a long career as an insurance producer and risk manager. And he also worked with the local service organizations to muster the resources of our congregations to address the needs of the world. Henry was born in Fort Worth. He graduated from Texas Christian University in 1975 with a BA in English and Biology. He was president and COO of Penner & Cheney, the paint contracting firm founded by his father, for 10 years before beginning his career in insurance. He retired in 2017. He loved photography, plucking his banjo, building his train layout, flying model airplanes, collecting stamps, and hunting and shooting with his father and his brothers. He liked listening to jazz music, with a scotch in hand and two or three books to read. The Deacon Henry Penner Education Fund has been established by Rhonda Penner and their extended family. Henry delighted in his calling as a deacon, and countless people were blessed by his ministry. In everything he did, Henry sought to lift up others and bring out the best in them. Contribution to this fund will be used to help with the education expenses for aspiring vocational deacons and to help with continuing education expenses for deacons currently serving in the church and the world. Those who wish to contribute to the Deacon Henry Penner Education Fund can do so through the online giving button on the diocesan website or by sending a check to the diocesan office. Sam Halsey. The Right Reverend Sam B. Halsey was born on Valentine's Day, of course, in 1932, and he died on the Feast of the Transfiguration, August the 6th, 2020. He was baptized and confirmed at St. Andrew's Episcopal Church in Fort Worth. As a priest, he served congregations in the Diocese of Dallas, Northwest Texas, and Tennessee. He was called to serve as the Bishop of Northwest Texas in 1980, and he served in that capacity until 1997. Sam was a truly remarkable bishop who led Northwest Texas to accomplish much, both within and beyond the diocese. His ability to remember names, and not only your name, but everyone in your extended family and their dog, and to write the personal handwritten notes from motel stationery or any scrap of paper, all of that was nothing less than legendary. He was truly interested in your life, and that's one way he showed it. His refusal to use email, social media, or answer his cell phone was equally legendary. Sam was a pastor at heart. It's true that he had a prophetic side, and occasionally he referenced himself as the Left Reverend rather than as the Right Reverend. He was always striving to learn, and he was always teaching. Even to the end, he was teaching us how to live and how to die. It was his pastoral impulse which made him a mentor and a spiritual director and a coach to many. There are lots of stories to tell, and I'm going to take the liberty to tell one. Some of you were there. Some of you know it. On January the 11th of this year, Sam preached the homily for the burial of Deacon Henry Penner at St. Martin in the Fields. Sam opened the sermon by telling us of his long connection to the congregation and to the Penner family dating back decades in West Fort Worth. He gave thanks to God for Henry and for his life and ministry, and he asked God's blessing on all those who mourn. And then Sam told the unsuspecting crowd, and there was a crowd, for this was before we knew about COVID, he told the crowd that he, Sam, was a brand new patient in hospice with incurable cancer. Everyone knew that he was battling cancer, but this was news, and people were shocked. So being the pastor who would anticipate our response and striving to take care of us, he offered some comic relief about his first encounter with his new hospice bath girl. On his first morning as a hospice patient, he received a call from someone who said, "Mr. Halsey, this is Terry. I'm your bath girl." Sam then told the crowd that he wanted everyone as witnesses, just in case I, as bishop, received any reports about Sam and his bath girl. It brought the house down when he looked at me and whispered into the mic that he was looking forward to it and he would give me a report. After the comic relief, what Sam preached was not unlike Jesus at the Last Supper. At the Last Supper, Jesus tells us his last words, so to speak. He has gathered his closest followers. It's the night before he will die, and he knows it. So he says and does the things that are most important, not things on the periphery, but things like sharing bread and wine. Do this in remembrance of me, and washing feet as one who serves, and commanding us, remember the Maundy Thursday commandment, commanding us to love one another. Sam ties the event of this burial office to the table, to the altar, where we share in the body and blood of Christ. He reminds us that Deacon Henry is participating with us in this sacred meal with all the saints. That this is not the end, for God will heal the broken body. He connects it all to the communion of saints and how reality does not end. Of course, Sam is going to interject the occasional editorial in the celebration of his Last Supper. Someone upon recently hearing that Sam was going to be going into hospice told him, "Now you're going to be with Jesus." And he replied, "Now excuse me, Jesus is everywhere. I'm already with Jesus." And then, given that this service was for a deacon, Sam moved to the topic of servanthood. Deacons are icons of servanthood, windows into what it means to be a servant. They're not our designated servants ordained to serve on our behalf. Rather, they lead the church into an interiority, a posture, an identity of serving, both within and beyond the church. So Sam remarked on his 23 years after serving as a diocesan bishop, which led to a pastoral role with a lot of other retired people. And he said, "I've discovered there are a lot of restless, lonely old people. And many of them have learned that playing bridge and golf are not going to get it. And if they want to find fulfillment and meaning, they've got to find a way to serve. And that can be done any number of ways, but primarily," he says, "we need to bear light. We need to be light bearers." So drawing from Bishop Halsey, the theme for this convention is taken from Jesus: "You are the light of the world." Light. The author and theologian Herbert O'Driscoll says, "Light is the predominant symbol in the expression of the Christian faith. The New Testament is full of it, beginning with the Gospels themselves. Light blazes in the heavens at the Lord's birth and emanates from him at his transfiguration. Shining figures appear at his ascension. He himself says that he is light, that he has come that humanity may have light." Jesus says, "You are the light of the world." Notice what Jesus does not say. He does not say, "You should be," or "You ought to be the light of the world." He does not say that you are called to be the light of the world. He does not implore us to be like light. He says, "You are the light of the world." You are. The word "are" derived from the verb "to be," as in "I am," "she is," "you are." It's your essence. The theological word for this is ontological, having to do with the nature of being or becoming or existence. You are light at the core of your being. If we wonder about that, we can turn to John's Gospel. We know from John's Gospel that Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." John the Baptist will say, referencing Jesus, "He is the true light." We know that. The prologue to John's Gospel says this: "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world." From the beginning, according to John's Gospel, the Word, the Christ, the light, divine presence, was embedded in all things. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. You are the light of the world. It's embedded. I suspect many of you are familiar with Richard Rohr, a Franciscan monk and theologian. Rohr observes that most of the world's religions claim something like this. They say, everything that exists in material form is the offspring of some primal source, which originally existed only as spirit. This infinite primal source somehow poured itself into finite visible forms, creating everything from rocks to water, plants, organisms, animals, and human beings, everything we see with our eyes. He says that this first self-disclosure of God into physical creation was actually the first incarnation, long before the personal second incarnation that Christians believe happened with Jesus. He says, to put this idea into Franciscan language, creation is the first Bible, and it existed 13.7 billion years before the second Bible was written. So the incarnation is not only God becoming Jesus, it is a much broader event. Long before Jesus' personal incarnation, Christ was embedded in all things. This is what we call an incarnational theology, a worldview which sees the presence of the divine in everything and everyone. Now, this is not a new 21st century innovative idea. It is not New Age. The early theologians of the church, in their writings, insist on claiming the presence of the divine in every human heart. In the second century, a great influential theologian, Justin Martyr, sees Christ the Logos, Christ the Word, as the cosmic sower who plants seeds of truth in the hearts of all human persons without exception. Centuries later, in the 20th century, Thomas Merton writes the following in his book, Guilty Bystander. He says this, at the center of our being is a point of nothingness which is untouched by sin, a point of pure truth, a point or spark which belongs entirely to God. It is like a pure diamond blazing with the invisible light of heaven. It is in everybody, and if we could see it, we would see these billions of points of light coming together in the face and blaze of the sun that would make all the darkness and cruelty of life vanish completely. He says, I have no program for this seeing. It's only a given. But the gate of heaven is everywhere. So we are created in the image of God, a fundamental starting point in Genesis. And it is our calling to grow into God's likeness, image and likeness, created in the image of God. Deep within the heart, the divine spark lives. And yet it's true, obviously, that each heart is greatly distorted by sin and is covered with layers and layers of fear and deception. And we could make a long list. And our calling is to grow into God's likeness. Obviously, we are not grown, so to speak. But according to Merton, there remains within us this innermost, secret, uncontaminated chamber of the heart where the winds of evil spirits do not blow. And this is the locus of God's indwelling. So while it's true that the Word was made flesh 2,000 years ago in a manger, and it's true that Christ is the full revelation of God, and Jesus is the ultimate outward visible sign of God's grace and love, an incarnational theology insists that the divine presence, light, can be found in every human heart. As the Anglican John Knox says, and this was written before we made our language inclusive, he says, man was made in the image of God and will not be allowed to fail in the end to realize his true nature and destiny. Divinity is not merely above him and around him, it is also within him. Indeed, it is the very essence of his inmost self. You are the light of the world. And then Jesus says, a city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. This is not a moment in history to keep the light under the bushel basket. The investor and philanthropist Warren Buffett says that when the tide goes out, you can see who's swimming naked. I suspect he's talking about the stock market and what happens when it crashes. But in early 2020, as COVID-19 rolled in, the tide rolled out, and much in this country was exposed. It's true that the light shines in the gloom, and we have witnessed amazing actions of sacrificial love during this pandemic. But there is no denying that much has been exposed. I could make a long list, but you know it already. You're living it. You know the deep divisions, the anger, the fear. I'm mindful of one of our former presidents of the United States who had a vision for our country. Maybe his vision came from his time under the big sky of Midland, Texas. Maybe he knew the quote from Thomas Merton. He challenged our country to be better, to be a kinder and gentler people, and to be 1,000 points of light. He imagined us as a nation of communities, a brilliant diversity spread like stars, like 1,000 points of light in a broad and peaceful sky. President George H.W. Bush, a faithful Episcopalian and a Texan. I want to say something about our particular peculiar light as Episcopalians, as Anglicans, beginning with our theological understanding of the Incarnation. It's been said that each of the great Christian traditions, and I'm talking about apostolic traditions, Eastern Orthodoxy, Roman Catholicism, and Anglicanism, that each of the three great traditions tends to emphasize a particular theological understanding. To the Eastern Orthodox, Easter is most emphasized. To the Roman Catholics, the sacrifice of Christ, the Passion, is most emphasized. To the Anglicans, it's the Incarnation. To be clear, none of the great traditions is saying it's just the Passion or it's just the Resurrection or just the Incarnation that matters. We are talking about the lens through which we tend to look. Our Anglican charism, our spiritual gift, is seeing the light in everything and everyone, even those whose light seems to be especially well covered. We know the light is there. And classic Anglican spiritual direction is inclined to draw out the light, to let light shine. We are not as inclined to drive out the bad as we are inclined to appeal to the good, the true, and the beautiful. As John says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not overcome it. That might be a helpful perspective right now, all the way around. Second, Anglican moral theology, our way of doing ethics, has at its heart character formation. In the various tough ethical questions we face, including the tough challenges with no good answers, we don't so much ask, what are we supposed to do? We ask, Who are we called to be? That is a pretty good question right now. Third, we have a history of striving for the middle way, not as a compromise, but rather through broad, comprehensive thought. I quoted from Father Jack Danforth last year, and I'll quote from him again this year. The former senator of Missouri says this. He says, "We are the middle way. We reject extremes. We do not insist on doctrinal purity. We allow a variety of beliefs in our common prayer. We welcome all to our altars. We boast of being inclusive. Our breadth is our strength, not our weakness." I would suggest the world needs more of that. And fourth and finally, 5 years ago, we called someone to serve as presiding bishop who declares boldly that if it's not about love, it's not about God. He reminds us how everything in the Bible, everything in the creeds, everything hangs on the great commandment to love God and love our neighbor. Love. He's not talking about affection, as wonderful as that is. He's talking about sacrificial love, undeserved forgiveness, unmerited grace, unconditional love. The kind of love which can crack open the tomb, crack open the layers and layers, the outer shell, and liberate the light. Bishop Curry spoke recently to the Executive Council of the Episcopal Church, and I had occasion to read what he said. As always, it was a sermon, and he chose a biblical text. I was surprised to see that he chose the exact text, the exact theme that we have for this diocesan convention. He told us something in that sermon that I did not know, and I would like to share it. He said this. He said, "I think often of my slave ancestors for whom darkness was a way of life. Imagine. I can't even imagine being taken and separated from my children and my family. I mean, being taken away from everybody that made Michael, Michael. I can't imagine being carted off to some place I never knew, packed in the holds of ships with other people, also captives, who spoke different languages. We couldn't even understand each other. I can't imagine being taken into new lands and feeling like a motherless child a long, long way from home. That feels about as dark as it can get. And yet those who were made captives, those captives are the ones who taught us to sing. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine." Bishop Curry concludes, "And if they could do it, we can do it. You are the light of the world. We are the light of the world. We did not do one thing to earn it or deserve it. By God's grace, we just are. So with gratitude, humility, and courage, and in the name of the Holy Trinity, one God in whom we live and move and have our being, let's let our light shine."
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, and in accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Friends, God commands us through Jesus Christ to love one another. In baptism, we promise to seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving our neighbors as ourselves, and to strive for justice and peace, and respect the dignity of every human being. Let us now honor those vows and pray for our nation, for wise and just leaders, and for the needs of others throughout our country and the world. We pray for continued blessings on all peacemakers, on leaders who value peace, and on everyone who promotes nonviolent solutions to conflict. We pray for a speedy end to all violence and warfare around the world. God of peace and of gentleness, hear our prayer. We pray for the strength of heart and mind to look beyond ourselves and address the needs of our siblings throughout the world. For the rural and urban poor, for the rebuilding of our communities, and for an end to the cycles of violence that threaten our future. God of generosity and compassion, hear our prayer. We pray for all nations, that they may live in unity, peace, and concord, and that all people may know justice and enjoy the perfect freedom that only God can give. God of liberty and freedom, hear our prayer. We pray that the Holy Spirit may embrace the most vulnerable members of our society. We pray also for an end to the growing disparity between the rich and the poor, and for the grace and courage to strive for economic justice. God of all gifts and blessings, hear our prayer. We pray for an end to prejudice throughout our country and the world, that we will respect all people as precious children of God, and that racism, sexism, and all other forms of discrimination will be forever banished from our hearts, our society, and our laws. God of fellowship and equality, hear our prayer. We pray for a reverence of creation, that we will have the tools and the will to conserve it, that we will use its bountiful resources in the service of others, and that we will become better stewards of all that has been entrusted to us. God of nature and the universe, hear our prayer. We pray for all immigrants, refugees, and pilgrims from around the world, that they may be welcomed in our midst and be treated with fairness, dignity, and respect. God of outcasts and wanderers, hear our prayer. We pray for the sick, the aged, and the infirm, for those with physical or mental disabilities, that all may have access to proper health care, and that God's loving embrace may be felt by all who suffer. God of comfort and healing, hear our prayer. We pray for all prisoners and captives, that a spirit of forgiveness may replace vengeance and retribution, and that we, with all the destitute, lonely, and oppressed, may be restored to the fullness of God's grace. God of absolution and mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all children and families, particularly for the orphaned, neglect, abused, and those who live in fear of violence or disease, that they may be relieved and protected. God of children and families, hear our prayer. We pray for the reconciliation of all people and for the church throughout the world, that it may be an instrument of your healing love. God of outreach and restoration, hear our prayer. We pray for all who have died as a result of violence, war, disease, or famine, especially those who died because of human blindness, neglect, or hardness of heart. God of eternal life and resurrecting love, hear our prayer. Let us pray for our own needs and the needs of others.
Grant, O God, that your holy and life-giving Spirit may so move every human heart, and especially the hearts of the people in this land, that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatreds cease. That our divisions being healed, we may live in justice and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Almighty God, source of all that is, giver of every good gift, you create all people in your image and call us to love one another as you love us. We confess that we have failed to honor you in the great diversity of the human family. We have desired to live in freedom while building walls between ourselves and others. We have longed to be known and accepted for who we are while making judgments of others based on the color of their skin or the shape of features or the varieties of human experience. We have tried to love our neighbors individually while benefiting from systems that hold those same neighbors in oppression. Forgive us, Holy God. Give us eyes to see you as you are revealed in all people. Strengthen us for the work of reconciliation rooted in love. Restore us in your image to be beloved community, united in our diversity, even as you are one with Christ and the Spirit, holy and undivided Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. God give you grace to try and to fail, to strive and to succeed, to dream the dreams of God, and to allow God to bring you to the fulfillment of those dreams, that you may flourish and the world may know God's glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen. Let us go forth rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Thanks be to God.